Welcome to the second lecture on Introduction to Spyder. In this lecture, we are going to see how to execute a Python file, how to execute few pieces of code using run, and how to add comments. And we will also see how to reset the environment and clear the console. So let's begin with file execution. On the top in the icon bar, you will see a green triangle with its end pointed to right. Now this is called the run file option, and this will help you run an entire file at once. An equivalent shortcut from the keyboard is to press F5. Now if you want to run few sections of code or few lines of code, then you can click on the run selection option, and this will help you run a chosen line. An equivalent shortcut from the keyboard is to either press F9 or press Ctrl Enter after choosing the line. So let's see how each of these options work and what are the corresponding outputs that they give. So I'm now first starting with the run file option, which will run an entire file at once. So once you have your code ready, you can click on the green triangle icon and you will see an output here. In this case, I am running the same script file that I used in my earlier lecture, now which says A is equal to 11, B is equal to A times 10. And print A comma B. So the output I am likely to get are the values of A and B here. So once you run the code, you will see the values being stored in the environment, and this you can find under the variable explorer. So in the variable explorer, you can see I have my values of A and B, and they are integer type. The size is 1 because they both have only one value, and the corresponding value is displayed. Now after I run on my console, I have the output here. So let me just zoom in to show you how does the output look. So this is my output. I have my value of A and B. A is 11, B is 110. Now since these were contained within the print statements, I will be getting only these two values as my output. So another thing to note is that whenever you click on the run file option, a corresponding function is run. So the run file command is actually the function that will be used to run an entire file at once. If you're not okay using the icon or the keyboard shortcut, you can also run your file using this command. The input to the run file function is the name of the file along with its entire directory. Now you also have another parameter called WDIR, which means working directory, and you can specify in whichever directory the file is residing. So for me, it's residing in the desktop, so I've given the same directory. So if you don't want to use the icon or the keyboard shortcut, you can also use the run file command. So in this case, since the output is contained within the print statement, you will be able to see only the output A and B. So now let's see how to execute few pieces of code using the run selection option or the F9 command from the keyboard. Now to my earlier code, I am assigning a value of 14 to A, and I am selecting the line, and I am then pressing F9. So I am just going to be using the shortcut here. You can also use this icon. Now once you select the line and press F9, you will see a corresponding output being displayed in your console. Now this says A is equal to 14. So whenever you use run selection command or F9, all these lines of code will be displayed in your console. So whatever I have shown you here is the console output. So now run the second line, which is B is equal to A into 10, and then press F9. Now once you do that, you will correspondingly see the code in your console. Then you can run the line which says print of A comma B, and once you run this line print of A comma B, you will see a corresponding output as well. So if you would have noticed, in run, every time you select a line and run it, the corresponding code is also displayed in the console. But however, if you are going to use a run file command which runs an entire file at once, then all these lines of code is not printed in the console. So this is also one of the difference between using a run file and a run selection command. So you can also use run selection to debug. So if you want to go through each and every line, and if you want to find out bugs or faults or mistakes that you would have done, then you can use the run selection option. So this is one of the major advantages of using run selection. But again, if you have a 1000 line, or if you have, so again, if you have a large code, then it's going to be impossible for you to use the run selection option. So now let's move on to commenting script files. So adding a comment will aid in the understanding of algorithms that have been used to develop a code. On my right, you can see a snapshot. Now this is a very trivial example that describes how a volume of cylinder is calculated. To comment any line, you basically begin with a hash. So here I have described the title of the task that I am going to do. Now I am going to calculate the volume of cylinder. Now apart from describing the task or the objective, you can also define what each of the variables mean in your code. So here I said dia is diameter, len is length and vol is volume. Now this is a very good practice because if you are going to give your code to someone or if you are going to revisit it in the future, you might want to know what you have done and why you have done it. Now you can also comment multiple lines instead of just one line. So to comment multiple lines, select on the lines that have to be commented and then press on Ctrl plus 1. Now this is a keyboard shortcut. An alternative way is to go to the edit option in the menu and then select comment or uncomment lines. So you can see the keyboard shortcut also being displayed just adjacent to the comment uncomment option under the edit menu. Like I earlier said, you can add description to your code to make it more comprehensible. But apart from just making it comprehensible, if you are in the beginning stage of developing a code where you are trying and testing out a few things, then you can also use commenting as a way of making a few lines inert. So what do I mean by this is that, so let's take the previous example where I say A is 14, B is A times 10 and print A comma B. Now I am just trying and testing out and seeing what will happen if I just comment A. So I am basically just making the first line inert and then running the successive lines. Now if you are playing with your code and you are in the developing stage, then you can also use commenting as a way of keeping lines inert. So now this is another use of commenting. So till now we have seen how to execute an entire file at once and how to execute few lines of codes. We have also looked at commenting as a way of adding description to your code. Now let's see how to clear the console and the environment. If you have an overpopulated console where you have printed multiple lines of codes and multiple outputs, then you might also want to just clear it off and start afresh. So let's take this example where I have run the codes. I have the same codes as earlier and I am just running them. So this is how my console looks right now. Now if I want to clear it, so you can type percentage clear in the console and once you hit enter, your entire console is cleared. Now an alternate way is to use the Ctrl plus L shortcut from the keyboard. That will also work. So this is to clear the console. Now once you clear the console, this is how it looks. I have a snapshot here that tells you how does the console look once you clear it. An important point to note here is that, so whenever I clear my console, only the output window is cleared. The variable explorer still remains intact, all the variables are still there. So clearing a console only means that you are just clearing or flushing out the output window. So now let's see, instead of just clearing the console, is there a way to just clear the environment as well? So I might also be interested in removing or deleting a few variables from my environment. So to begin with, I have two variables in my environment, which is A and B. And they have a value of 14 and 140 respectively. So let's see how to remove or delete these variables. Now to remove a single variable, you can just give del space followed by the variable name. Now this you can type in the console. So del stands for delete and it has to be followed by a space and then a variable name. Now once you hit enter, what you will see is that one of the variables, in this case B, has been removed from the environment. So here you can see variable B has been removed from the environment. Now instead of removing a single variable, we can also remove multiple variables from the environment. Now we will still use the same command del, but instead of just giving one variable, you will give two variables and you have to ensure that you separate the variables with a comma. Now if you are typing along with me, please ensure that B is also present in the environment and then you can type this code. So once you hit enter, you can see that the entire memory has been flushed out and both these values have been deleted. So instead of dropping variables one by one, you might also be interested in clearing the entire environment at once. So there are two ways to go about it. The first way is to use a percentage reset command in the console. Now once you type percentage reset and hit enter, it will prompt you with a line that reads as, once deleted, variables cannot be recovered, proceed yes or no. Y stands for yes and N stands for no. Now this is to ensure that you have not typed percentage reset accidentally, and this is just another layer of check to make sure that you don't flush out the important variables in your environment. Now if you would like to proceed, then type Y, otherwise you can type N. Now once you hit enter, you will see that the entire environment has been cleared out. So this is using a command. Now let's see how to clear the environment using an icon. Now above the variable explorer, there are a couple of icons here. The one on the extreme right looks like an eraser. So now click on the icon, it will prompt you with the dialog box. If you click OK, all the variables will be removed. So while it is removing variables, it also prompts with a line that says removing all variables. So till now we've seen how to execute an entire file or few lines of codes, and how to comment the code that you've written, and how to clear the console and the environment. So now let's take a look at some of the basic libraries in Python. Now there are four major libraries that get installed at the time of installation of Python. These are NumPy, which stands for numerical Python, Pandas, which stand for paneled data frames, matplotlib, which stands for visualization, and sklearn, which is used for machine learning. So these are four major libraries that are important to solve a data science problem. So these are parent libraries. There are also sub libraries contained within these. So to access the contents of a library, you need to first import the library. In this case, I am importing NumPy. Now dir represents directory, so this is the directory of the library, in this case it's NumPy. Now I am just saving the entire directory onto a variable name called content, and I am just printing the object content. So once you run these three lines of code on your console, all the sub libraries will be printed. So this is one way to actually access the sub library. So now this is a little tedious because you actually have to skim through all the sub libraries to know what they consist of, and also your console gets overpopulated. Now under the help tab you have a search box that's titled as object. Let me just zoom in to show you how it looks. Now under object you are going to mention your library name. So in this case I have mentioned NumPy. The moment you hit enter, a documentation pops up. Now the documentation tells you what Python does, what it provides, and how to use the documentation. Now apart from that, if you scroll down, you can also see a list of sub libraries that are available under NumPy. So the sub libraries available under NumPy are linear algebra, Fourier transform routines, polynomial tools, so on and so forth. Now if you want a specific documentation for each of these sub libraries, so you can type in the library name in the search box, follow it up with the dot and then the sub library name. So let's say if I want to access the sub library lib from NumPy, then I'm going to write numpy.lib under the search box object. So this is how you get a detailed documentation of all the libraries and sub libraries in Python. So to summarize, in this lecture we saw how to execute Python script files, how to comment single lines of codes and multiple lines of codes, how to clear the console and the environment, and how to access some of the basic libraries in Python. Thank you.